H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Properly or not? Good. So we have three files created, right? PIG1, PIG2 and PIG3. So PIG1 is containing this sample data. ABC, ABC, AAA, 1, 2, 3 or something. Just a combination of numbers and letters. And PIG2 is containing some combinations of XYZs. So this is fine. And PIG3, it is having a combination of PQRs. Okay. All good. So the next one is entering into the PIG shell. So for that we are entering with the default mode, which is MapReduce mode, right? So first of all, let me go to PIG home. So wherever you have installed PIG, you have to go to till that path and then you can give your PIG command. So now if you see here, you have entered into a shell called as grunt shell. So from here only my PIG scripts will be able to get executed. But till now, if I write any of my PIG script elsewhere, maybe something at here at this position or at this position, the cluster might not be able to understand it. But from grunt shell only, it will be able to take the inputs of all PIG commands. So now, first I will load the data of PIG1 into my PIG system. Okay, so the step that I'm going to use is load command. So here I am writing is PIG1 is equal to load whatever the PIG1 file that I am having in the path of my HDFS as F1 of char array, F2 of char array and F3 of int. Okay. So if you remember my PIG1 file, it is like character character followed by an integer. So that's the reason I'm giving it as char array and int. As I'm knowing the schema, I'm declaring it as something F1 of char array, F2 of something, F3 of int. If at all I'm not aware of my input file, I can just skip this part. So this is an optional area. If at all you know the schema, well and good, go ahead and declare. If that's not the case, no issues, you can leave that step. Okay, so now that is done. As I told you, as and when I give a PIG command, it is not going to be executed until and unless I give a dump command. So let me give dump command and we will see if it gets executed or not. Now if you observe here, internally a MapReduce program is being executed. See, if you see the commands here, every command is having MapReduce layer dot job controller compiler and all those things. So a jar file will be created internally and that is how it can be executed on our cluster. So again, it's almost similar like our MapReduce program execution only, right? So 50% and all those things. And then finally, it will go show you all your job statistics as well. So how much time it has taken, how many MapReduce programs were successfully executed, how many records that were created in our output alias, all those things, and all the counter information, all the record information, byte informations, and all those things will be shown over there. So if you see your job tracker here, a new job ID is created. So this job ID is nothing but the job ID for your dump program itself. So it has been given a priority and it is showing the percentage of completion. So a map task has been executed internally and another reduce task has been executed internally. But for you, are you aware of anything that you had written some map program or reduce program? No, right? You had just written a sample load command and executed it. So but still it has created one map task and reduce task. Okay. So and dump pig one is nothing but it is showing whatever that is there in your pig file. So I just loaded it, but still I didn't do any operation, and that's the reason you are able to see the whole file. So in the same way, let me load pig2 also. Just to make you comfortable, I am trying to give dump command for each of the statement that I am giving. So this is having XXXA. If you remember the file that we had seen in HDFS, it is nothing but these values only, right? So it is just represented in the form of tuples. So now I'm loading the last file, which is pig3. Okay, so just I will let you know one more thing. So again, in the backend, you have few libraries declared for pig also. So whenever your Hadoop was introduced or your Hadoop was written, internally they had given few libraries for pig also. So they had declared few libraries. So through that libraries only our pig commands will be able to get executed. So whatever the libraries that we are giving in MapReduce, we are declaring it in our program. But for pig, all these libraries will be internally invoked and through which we can execute our pig commands. Okay. So fine. We had written all those things. Now let's try to union the pig2 and pig3 aliases. And one point you have to remember during union execution is union will be able to perform only if both the aliases are in same format. In the sense, my pick 3 has first element as character array, second as character array, and third as character array. And whereas if you see my pick 1, it is having character array and int. So at that moment, if you give union command, my output is my output will just skip the third column and it will give you only the first and second columns. So the columns should be matched before I execute union command to get proper results. So here if you see, it is just an append to my first file. So the first file ends with x, y, x and z, and the third file is starting from pq or s. So this is pick 3 and pick 4. So it's just a combination. No, Rahul, there is no way to suppress these messages, because whenever you execute a program, you cannot suppress the execution displays, right? So these are all execution commands. Yeah, so you will not be able to suppress them. So you have to wait until all those commands go and to see your final output. So that's what the union command is about. So next, let's go to next slide. And now let us see few other transformations. So we had covered the union transformation, and the next part would be covering about distinct, split and filter. So union can contain duplicate tuples as well, because union has no mind to differentiate each of the tuple. What its function is, it will just append the second file to first file. That's it. It will not do any other function. But if you give distinct, it will remove all the duplicate tuples. So it is as similar as SQL or DB2. So the distinct command has the same functionality as in SQL. So it will remove all the duplicates if at all I have anything declared in my tuples of a particular file. So I will not be able to execute this distinct command because my files are unique. So if you see here, each tuple is different when compared to other tuples, right? So even though I execute the distinct command, I would be getting all the 8 rows. For example, if I am having the first row repeated again, maybe at some place of the file, not immediately, or maybe in the second file as x, x and a, I would be getting only one single tuple in my output if I give a distinct on this variable, on this alias. So if I apply distinct on pick 4, then I would be getting x, x, a only once, even though I had a repetition of it. Okay. So that's what I'm trying to say, tell you. So distinct of P4. So this is what the representation is, and I'm storing it somewhere on in an alias called as pig5. So it will be nothing but same as pig4 only, because all are distinct records. The next one is split. As the name represents, I am trying to split a particular file into two separate records. So split is nothing but opposite of union. So the split command format is split alias into some name if f1 is equal to 0 and into some other name if f2 is equal to 1. So what I am trying to represent here with F1 and F2 is, F1 represents the first column and F2 represents the second column. So as I am knowing those schemas, I am directly giving as F1 and F2. What if I doesn't know the schema? Because my file is very huge and it might be a combination, and I cannot give a schema for that. So at that moment, I would be representing it with a dollar value. Then I will give as dollar of 0, which represents my first column, and dollar of 1, which represents my second column in my file. So in this statement, I am trying to split all the records in a column starting with 0 into a file called as D, and all the second columns starting with 1 into a file called as E. Okay, so dump D will give, so let me write the A's and B's first of all. Instead of writing this, comma 2 and 1, comma 7, comma 8. So that is what my A and B is, right? Okay. So now what I am doing is, okay, what is my C value? Let me write it, guys. One second. So my C is nothing but combination of these three. So that is my A, this is my B, and I had performed a operation called as union, and that's the reason I'm having all these values in C. Okay, now I am doing distinct of C into D. It doesn't have any duplicates, and that's the reason you are having like that the same value. And now on C I am applying a split command into D and E. So my D will have all the first columns starting with 0, so that's the reason I am having here the first column with the same, and E will have all the second columns, sorry, all the first columns starting with 1. Okay, so this record and this record will come into one file, and this record will come into another file. So that's what the split command does. And the next one is filter. So filter is nothing but, I will try to filter few records. It's nothing but a filtration of few records from my whole file. So as my C contains all these values, I'm trying to give the filter the records which were greater than 3. So if at all I dump F, it will give you 052 and 178, because here my second columns should be greater than 8. In my whole 4 tuples, I have only 2 columns which are having greater than 3, and that is 5 and 7, right? So that's the reason I am getting only these 2. Let me show you filter also once. Guys, are you able to hear me? Hello. Okay. I'm just getting a notification, so that's the reason I'm asking you. So let us try this. So if you see my big one, it is having all these records, right? My big one file contains all these records, and what I am trying to do is, I am filtering only the records that are having the column 3 less than 11. So you should get only few records in your output. So I am getting only the first three tuples, that is 1, 2, 3. Because I am retrieving all the records less than 11. If you see all the next records, they are greater than 11 or at least equal to 11. Right? So that's the reason I am filtering all these records. So that's what it says. So, and the next set of transformations are simple and limit. Sorry, sample and limit. So, sample is, in general, in real world, we would be doing any functions or doing any transformations, applying these transformations on very huge amount of data. It will be in terabytes, right? And if at all I want to do some testing on some amount of data, I don't need all the data exactly. I just need a sample of that whole huge data. So, because just to do some initial analysis or something like that, I don't need or I don't actually require all the data that was available or that stored on my cluster. So, I just need a sample of it. So, for that, I would be using a command called as sample to fetch only some amount of data from my whole huge data set. And here, if I give a sample command, the results are completely random and every time we will be getting different values. So, suppose I am having 100 records in my whole dump and if I give a sample command on those 100 records, every time I would be fetching some 10 records or maybe 20 records or something like that. And these will be in the random order only. So it's not like it will fetch only the first 10 records or only the first 20 records. It will try to fetch all the different combinations that were available in my huge data set and it will try to give you the best sample. So the representation is x equal to sample C0.01. In the sense, I'm trying to retrieve 1% of data from my C data set. So, generally the sample would be given in percentage. So, randomly samples a relation, the sampling factor is given at the end. So, it will be followed by the sample command. For example, a 1% sample of data in a relation which is a huge data set would be resulting in a small data which is X, which is 1% of my C. The operation is probabilistic in such a way that the size of small data will not be exactly 1% of large data. And there is no guarantee the operation will return the same number of tuples each time. Okay, so if at all I give 1% or even though I declare 1%, it will not exactly fetch 1%. Suppose if I have 100 records, it's not that I get only one record or maybe let me take some 1000 records. So 1% of 1000 would be some 10 records or whatever. I don't get the percentages. So if at all 1% is 10 records, it's not like every time I would be getting 10 records randomly. Sometimes I may get 8 records or sometimes I may get 9 records out of my huge data set. So, but I can guarantee until that I would be getting only 1% but not beyond that. But it will be less than that exact 1% also. Okay. Okay, I think limit command is missed here. Okay, let me explain you the limit command also. Seems it was missed here. The limit command will allow you to specify only few tuples to return back. So, for example, I am having, if you take this itself, if you take the pig1 file, I am having 6 records here, right? So, if at all I give a limit command as some abc is equal to limit pig1 3, something like this, abc equal to limit pig1 3, then I will be fetching only 3 tuples from my whole file. So it is like limiting your amount of data that you are fetching from a particular file. So again here the limit will not guarantee you that it will be fetch only the first three records. So it will fetch in random, and every time you would be getting different set of values. So that's what the limit command is about. So these are all like kind of a simple commands where you can easily understand. If at all you are able to understand the English language itself, because it is like self-representation. Each one is load means obviously it will load. Limit means it is going to limit the amount of data you are going to fetch. Or maybe union is just the union of records. So it's like general normal English representation where everyone can easily able to understand. That's the reason PIG has got that importance when compared to MapReduce in most of the cases. Okay, so let us go back to our slide. And the next transformation is order. So here also, as the name represent, order will order all your records of your input file. So the representation of order is alias equal to order alias by field. So here both the alias are not common. Don't get confused. So you are ordering some alias whatever that was available with you and storing that output into another alias, maybe some other name. Here I can give the order in different ways, might be ascending or might be descending. Okay, so let's try to execute this command. Okay, so here what I am doing is order pick one by F1 ascending, right? So by taking the first column, and I am trying to order all my columns of F1 with ascending. So let's see how it works. So this is my input actual data of pig one, right? So let's see how it happens once this order command is executed. As it is a simple command, you are feeling that okay, for a simple operation, why it is having multiple MapReduce commands happening internally. But in general, the pig commands will be very complex, and in most of the cases, the operation that you are going to do is not like a straightforward operation, or there will be multiple commands that will be written for each of a pig functionality. So at that moment you will not feel something bored or something, you know, waste of time of getting all these execution commands. Okay, so your input is in different ways. So if you see, the first column is starting with A, and this the same A value is represented again on your fourth row. But once you ordered, all your columns are getting together at some one particular area. So the A and A are coming together, and B's are coming together, and C's are coming together, because I had given it in ascending order. So it is starting with A. If at all I give with descending, it will start with C record and then B records and then A records. So that's what my output looks like. Okay. So, any questions on this? Okay. Good. So here, if you read this, sort a relation based on one or more fields. Okay, we are fine with this statement. And then, if you retrieve the relation right after the order operation by dump or store, it's guaranteed to be in desired sorted order. So for example, if your order statement is the last statement in your whole PIC scripts, then it is sure that you would be getting it in sorted order. But still, if your order is suppose you have totally 10 commands in your PIC script, and if your order statement is some fourth or fifth command, it's not mandatory that you would be getting the final output results in sorted order, because after that you might be giving few other commands like filter or distinct or something else, union, maybe few other commands are also available. So after the order command is executed and if anything else is done on top of it, it's not guaranteed that you would be getting in some order what you are, whatever you had declared. So most of the cases, try to have your order operation at the end of your script if you are expecting to have your output in particular order. Okay. So let us talk about few other transformations called as describe and group. So this is what actually the C is containing as per our examples which we are seeing. And if I say describe C, it will give you as it has three tuples and each it has four tuples and each tuple is containing a different columns, each of integer type. So the describe command will give you the actual schema of whatever the alias you are representing. Okay, so I will show you this this describe command after giving some few other commands, because then you will try to understand what exactly describe will give. But for now, if you apply describe for PIC 1, again you will get it in this format only, because there are no manipulations or functionalities that were happened on PIC now at this point of time. So you will get the same way. Right? So because you haven't done anything and PIC 1 is a straightforward alias which you had generated only from a single file. But if you club two files and generate some new alias, at that moment you will be able to understand how describe actually works or how it actually show you the schema of that output alias. So it is not the schema that was representing your file, it is the schema representing the output of your alias or maybe the final output. Okay. And the next one is group command. Okay, so group is nothing but you will group few columns by a particular condition. So here I am trying to give as group C by A3 and I am storing it into G. Okay. And if I say dump G, if you observe here C record, you are having two tuples. So if you observe the first two tuples, the last column is having the same value 2 and 2. So that is the reason whenever you dump G, the 2 will be represented as a key and then the tuples that will be followed. So as I told you, it will not be a direct output and your final output will be represented as group comma followed by number of bags, right? That is what my general outputs of my aliases look like. So this is a sample example showing you that particular format, and then 4 followed by 1, 3, 4 and 8 followed by 178. So for example, if you are having one more tuple called as 6, 5 and 8, then you would be getting, or then you would be grouping the tuple into your third key value pair. So that is 8, 178, and again one more tuple will be added as 5, 6, 8 or something like that. So that's what the group functionality. So it will be grouping based on a particular condition or maybe particular column also. So now I will show you how the describe actually works. Okay, so what I am doing is, on pig1 file I am grouping it by F1, so I am grouping it by column 1. So let me execute this command. Right now this is my input in pig1, right? So I am grouping it on first column. So all A's should come together and all B's should come together and all C's should come together as group, collection of tuples into a single bag. Okay, so if you see the output, the first element is represented with a group, comma, collection of tuples. So here the output is changing to groups but not by actual elements, right? But till now whatever we had seen the normal outputs or just filtrations or something. Here you are representing your first element with a group, and by default it will be giving the group name only. You cannot change this group name also. Okay, and the second elements again followed in the same format, and again we can perform grouping by one of the expression of a column as well. As I told you, here I had performed grouping on a particular column, but rather than column I can give an expression also here. For example, I'm having employee ages, so I'm having some 10 employee records, and in each of the whole record I'm having a column of employee age also. So if at all I want to group it by an expression of age, then I will give it as something like group employee by age by 2 or something age by 3. So each employee's age will be divided by 2, and if at all if it matches with any of the employee's age, then all those ages will be clubbed together and represented as a single group, comma, collection of those tuples for that particular age. So that's what group talks about. So if at all the condition is satisfied, then only a bag is being prepared and it will be showing you in your output. So for example, you don't have any elements of this A, then you will be not be able to see the whole bag. It will be an empty bag. So it will be like A comma curly braces open and close, and then B comma tuples if at all if you have any matching conditions, and C comma tuples followed as the same. So it's not like mandatory that I have to get something on my representation of bags. It can be empty also. Okay. Okay. So Just let's talk something more about group also. Note that one can group by any function or expression. For example, if time is a timestamp and there exists a function day of week, one can conceivably do this by grouping, that would be creating a relation. So here I can give functions as well. So there is one internal function or built-in function that was declared called as day of week, and I can give that function as well on a particular field, and I can group it by those results also. So it can be an expression or function or maybe a column or anything like that, but group will be able to accept all those combinations. Okay, so here I have given the terminology, but still I hope you all know about these terminologies. So the outputs would be stored into a some variable which is called as alias here, and each of the relations rows are called as tuples, and the list of tuples are called as bags, and bag itself now is containing the collection of tuples only, right? So I'm not going to explain these things again because I hope everyone is aware of this aliases, tuples and bags. So any questions here before I go ahead? Okay, this timestamp a type. Yes, Rahul, yeah. I mean, as common with SQL, timestamp is a type. So it would be represented like date, I mean, sorry, year followed by month followed by date followed by actual time, seconds, minutes, all those will be there. So timestamp is also a type. So if anyone is aware of DB2, a timestamp is a default type that is having a length of 24, right? Hopefully if anybody knows DB2, they will understand how the timestamp would be represented in general. So it will be followed by year, month, date, minutes, seconds, milliseconds, like that it will be followed. So it will be a total length of 24. Okay. Fine. Good. So let us see a transformation which we will wind up for today. So it is nothing but cogroup. So there is some difference between group and cogroup. Let us understand that, okay? So cogroup groups together tuples from multiple relationships. It functions much like a join. But don't confuse about what is the difference between join and cogroup. Once I explain join, I will tell you or explain you what is the exact difference. But first of all, try to understand what cogroup is. So grouping, we will be doing it on a single relation or maybe on a single file. But when you come to cogroup, you would be joining multiple relations here. So you will be applying your function on multiple files. So here I am having two files A and B, and the command I would give to cogroup is cogroup A by A3, B by B3 and store it into an alias called as J. Let us try doing it. Okay, so you all remember that we have two files, right? PIG1 and PIG2. So I am trying to apply the cogroup functionality on both these two files. So I am cogrouping PIG1 by F1 and PIG2 by F3. So, and one more point that you have to remember before cogrouping is the element which you are trying to have as a key for cogrouping should be available on, or at least it should be the same format in both of these two files. Okay, so here I am cogrouping with column 1 on pig 1 file and column 3 on pig 2 file. So all these elements will get together. So the element A's will be coming together or grouped together, and element B's, whatever that were available on pig 1 and pig 2 file, will be grouped together, and same for the remaining elements also. So let us try to execute this command. Okay, let me hide the results. Can anyone tell me what would be the output? So is everyone able to see the pig 1 and pig 2 inputs? So these are the inputs, and I am co-grouping like this. Co-group pig 1 by F1 and pig 2 by F3. So can anyone ping me the output of co-group var on how it look like? So I will give you a hint also. It is as common as group followed by collection of tuples. So tell me how would my output look like. Come on guys, take a shot. Let it be, even if it is wrong, no issues, right? I just wanted you to try it, that's it. Okay. So Rahul is saying as A comma A1 and XX. Okay. Fine. Anyone else? Come on, Arjun, Akshay, Nisha, Prabitha, at least I want one more guy to reply. Okay, no worries. Rahul, you are near. I mean, the combination how you are going to try is perfect, that is fine, but the representation of the tuple will not be divided, it will be as a whole. So if you observe the tuple here, it is like a comma 1. Okay, so the combination would be like group comma the whole tuple value. So a comma 1, and then a comma AA comma 1, a comma AAA comma 1. So it would be in that way. Okay, so the group name and then followed by the whole tuple, but not the tuple is going to get divided. So even if you see the second file's tuple also, it is having the whole value XXA, but it's not going to divide. It's just the key and then values, that's it. B comma B comma 2 B comma BB2, so on and so forth. So that's how the co-group functionality is about. So any questions, guys? We will wind it for today, and we will see few other transformations tomorrow, and hopefully we would be finishing pig by tomorrow, and we will start talking about hive from our next class. So in our next class tomorrow at the same time, I will try to conduct the class, and I will finish pick and we will just have a basic introduction of Hive also. So, any questions before I wind up for the day? Yes, Prabita. Okay. Okay, fine. I mean, I think he would be sending you, but hopefully by the next week I would be finishing all these classes and all this set of collections again I would be sending it to Vamsi once the classes are done. So till now whatever that was available, whatever the recorded sessions that I had shared with Vamsi, he would be sharing with you. And all the I think from mid of MapReduce I had to share with him. So by next week I would be sharing all these videos, because sharing at once will help you also, because I would try to give some more information on each of the topic also. Oh good, fine. Okay. Okay, okay. So did you face any issue during the download of Ubuntu? Yeah, of course, it will be a bit huge file. So you should have some, I mean, you know, good internet service to download Ubuntu. It will be a ISO file, but it will be a big file, of course. It will take some time. Don't worry. Yeah, sure. Sure, Pravita. Sure, okay, no issues. Okay. Fine, guys. Thank you for joining the class today. We will meet at the same time tomorrow. Okay? Have a good night.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.